Lymphocytes. What? Hi guys, welcome to another video of Life with Juan. It's taken me so long to make this video, I'm so sorry. It was a lot of material to go through. Actually, it took me a while to understand, but I wanted to make sure that I understood it well enough so I could present it to you guys. So here is my video on lymphocytes. Coincidentally, I'm doing my ophthalmology rotations right now, and lymphocytes kind of look like tiny eyeballs floating around in your bloodstream. At least that's what I think. These essentially derive from multipotent stem cells, which are the precursor of all other blood cells as well. These are found in the bone marrow, and when it's exposed to IL-2, multipotent stem cells will turn into lymphoid progenitor cells. So that's why in several diseases like lymphoblastic leukemia, you want to suppress the production of lymphocytes, and hence you'll use drugs that inhibit IL-2 and its target. So what are lymphocytes? These are type of white blood cell, and these originate from bone marrow, but as their name suggests, they develop in lymphoid tissue. And their maturation is driven by antigen response, or by exposure to antigens. Antigens are these protein patterns that are displayed by bacteria or viruses or even rogue self cells that will drive a lymphocytic response. So once a lymphocyte is stimulated, these will undergo clonal growth. That means they're going to multiply several times over so that they can mount a sufficient defense against the source of that antigen. So anyway, there are three main kinds of lymphocytes. There are B lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, and NK cells, or natural killer cells. Let's start with B cells. B cells comprise 10% of all lymphocytes, and these are in charge of producing antibodies. What are antibodies? Well, I'll explain those later. They display around 100,000 antibodies on their cell membrane, and these serve as receptors for antigens. When a B cell is exposed to an antigen that stimulates it, it transforms into a plasma cell. It's like B cell in Super Saiyan mode, where it starts releasing antibodies into the serum or the humor. Hence, B cells are very important for humoral immunity. That means that they're responsible for the body's immunity by means of the chemicals floating around in their blood serum. Okay, so humoral immunity consists of antibodies as well as the complement or antibodies binding to antigens, as well as several proteins and interleukins and cytokines that are floating around in your system. So, B cells undergo a process of gene rearrangement in order to produce antibodies. This is for the expression of light and heavy chains. These are regions that are present in your antibody. So here's a demonstration of how this happens. Your B cell floating around in your blood, and it's exposed to a bacteria that triggers its antibodies on its surface. When it's triggered, it starts transforming into a plasma cell and releasing antibodies into the serum. So, how do B cells develop? We mentioned the lymphoid progenitor cell. This then turns into a pro-B cell, which expresses kappa and lambda chains. These are like the primitive antibody chains. Then, the pro-B cell turns into the pre-B cell, which produces the mu constant region of the heavy chain. Pre-B cells also express terminal deoxynucleotide transferase. This is an enzyme that's important for splicing the B cell's DNA, which is important for its rearrangement. After a few touches here and there, the pre-B cell transforms into a mature B cell. A mature B cell has not yet been exposed to antigens, and therefore still expresses surface immunoglobulins. These are IgM and IgD that are displayed on its surface, and you can see these in your bone marrow, in your spleen, and in your lymph nodes. When these are exposed to complementary antigens, these are activated and transform into plasma cells. Plasma cells cease production of CD19 and CD20 and start exclusive production of antibodies as well as CD38. So what are antibodies? Again, these are important glycoproteins or sugar protein complexes that are needed in humoral immunity. These consist of four polypeptide chains. Two of these are light chains and two of these are heavy chains. And all of these are connected to each other by disulfide bonds or sulfur bonds. And these have constant and variable regions. Constant regions consists of the COOH end or the carboxyl end of the heavy chain, and the variable region consists of the amino end of the heavy chains and the light chains. And then there are five different classes of antibodies. So here's a basic structure of what your antibody looks like. It looks like a letter Y, and it consists of two light chains and two heavy chains. This over here is one light chain, and this over here is another light chain. And this is a heavy chain, that four chain sequence over there. There's also a heavy chain. Now, you can see over here, the yellow, that's the constant region of the heavy and the light chains, and the green are the variable regions. This consists of the VDJ sequence. That's simply the rearrangement of chains that form the variable region that complements to antigens in your system. Now, likewise, you can see these little bonds over here, the tiny one over here, that one over here, that one over here. Those are the disulfide bonds. Essentially, when you have a bacteria, it's going to bind to the green region. And then over here, the long yellow region, that's going to bind to like macrophages for complement activation. So essentially, how it works is that the green region will bind to your bacteria and it's going to tag them. And then macrophages are going to recognize this end, and they're going to go and engulf said bacteria and get ready to present their antigens to T cells, which we're going to explain later. So that's, again, the variable region, and then that's the constant region, yellow. So B cell gene rearrangement is essentially the rearrangement of the heavy and the light chains that occurs in the lymphoid stem cell. So this is important for antibody diversity because each B cell can only display one kind of antibody. And so you have so many B cells floating around in your system. And that's why you have protection against a wide variety of bacteria and viruses. So this rearrangement happens for each individual kind of B cell for the light and the heavy chains. So there are five checkpoints of B cell gene rearrangement. The first checkpoint is the formation of the surrogate light chain pairs to form a pre-B cell receptor. So this serves as a liaison, a stand-in, if you will, for while the light chain still has not rearranged. It occurs in the bone marrow or in the liver if you're still in the womb. So second point, autoreactivity of the pre-B cell receptor, IgH, occurs in the marrow or the liver. It's like a test run, if you will, of whether or not the pre-cell receptor is able to react to antigen exposure. Next, you have positive selection. Immature B cells are exposed to autoantigens. So autoantigens are essentially antigens that come from your own cells. So if a B cell binds tightly to your own cells, it means there's a failure of the mechanism because you want your B cells' antibodies to bind to foreign antigens. And if it expresses affinity that's too strong for self-antigens, these are deleted. And this occurs as the B cell progenitors exit the bone marrow. Next, the negative selection. While positive selection is removal of B cells that do react to your own antigens, negative selection is removal of B cells that don't react to foreign antigens. So this happens in the spleen. Of course, B cells wouldn't function well if they didn't react to anything, right? And so they need to react to something. And that's why you need to expose them to foreign antigen that will stimulate them, promote their growth, and their differentiation into plasma cells. Next, once these are circulating around in the serum, exposure of B cells to foreign antigen cause B cell proliferation and formation of plasma cells. And IgH, which is the surrogate light chain pair that functions as a stand-in, transforms into the IgG, the IgA, or the IgE. These are the later forms of antigens that form from the plasma cells. These don't form in unstimulated B cells. So this happens in your lymph nodes, particularly in the follicular centers. So antibody diversification, I mentioned this earlier, occurs during the development of B cells, and it essentially is the formation of the variable region, or the complementary region rather, of the B cell. And the complementary region consists of the VDJ. VDJ recombinase and RAG proteins are important for the rearrangement of said genes so that the B cell antibody can have diversity in its receptor region. Okay, so there's random loss of nucleotides in the right, the hypervariable region, that's what it's called, causing diversification. This loss happens due to the enzymes, the recombinase and the RAG proteins. And remember your basic genetics, nucleotides are read in multiples of three in order to express proteins. And if this happens, if this deletion of nucleotides at the variable region happens in non-multiples of three, say four or two, you can have a frame shift that may result in a loss of function in your antibody. So this receptor editing allows in a change in antibody specificity, and B cells then become monospecific to a single antigen. So, as I said earlier, one B cell can produce one antibody. So it's only one kind of antibody per B cell. So that's why you have a lot of B cells, because you need to express a lot of antibodies to mount that wide defense. There are five kinds of antibodies. First are IgM and IgD. As I said earlier, these are expressed in B cells that have not been exposed to foreign antigens. So IgM is the first kind of antibody. It's expressed on the B cell surface, and it's also released when a foreign antigen is first recognized by a B cell. This promotes phagocytosis and activates the complement system. As I mentioned, the hypervariable region will bind to bacteria, and then the heavy chain, the constant region, will attract macrophages, which will then phagocytose said bacteria. And then IgD is another antibody that's first released by B cells. Its function is still not fully known, actually. And then you have IgA, G, and E, which are the later antibodies that are released by plasma cells. So IgA, you find this a lot in the mucosa of lymphoid tissues. And you also find this in your gut, in your intestines. This is your body's initial defense against viruses and bacteria. Next, you have IgG, which is highly concentrated in your blood plasma. It helps in coating foreign particles for phagocytosis, or opsonization. It's like glazing the foreign particle so that your macrophage can eat it. So IgG, Ig glaze, that's what I like to use to remember IgG's function. And then next is IgE, which is important for the allergic response as it recruits eosinophils. So IgE, eosinophils. It's also important in helminthic reactions, since eosinophils react to helminths, or worms, parasites. Okay, that's so much for B cells. Next, we have T cells. Now, because B cells are important for humoral immunity, T cells, on the other hand, are important for cellular immunity. You have two kinds of T cells. You have the helper cells, which augment the cellular immune response. And these express CD4. And these interact with phagocytic cells like macrophages and dendritic cells. Then you have the cytotoxic T cells, which express CD8 and kill infected cells. Okay, so here are your two kinds of cells for visual purposes. This is our T helper cell, and then this is our T cytotoxic cell. So let's see what happens. As I said, your T helper cell will bind to macrophages that have phagocytosed bacteria. The macrophages, again, these express bacterial antigens on their surface, and that's what the T cell recognizes via CD4 and MHC2. I'm going to talk about that later. Now, when it recognizes that antigen bound to the MHC2 protein, it's activated and starts releasing all these cytokines, all these interleukins into the plasma that trigger further inflammatory response. Next, you have the T killer cell, the cytotoxic T cell, if you will. And this is important for detecting corrupted cells that are expressing corrupt self-antigens on MHC1. Again, this has CD8. CD8 is important for binding to MHC1. And what happens is it binds to a corrupt cell, in this case, a corrupt epithelial cell. And the epithelial cell will be exposing MHC1, and the MHC1 will be exposing a corrupted self antigen. And when that happens, it triggers apoptosis in the corrupt epithelial cell, or corrupt cell for that matter, and it's gonna burst. Apoptosis. Not burst, but it's gonna start blebbing, it's gonna start turning into tiny balls that slowly drift away into non-existence. So, as again, I mentioned the MHC complex, which is important in binding to T cells and presenting antigens to T cells. These react with your T cell receptors. So there are two major types of MHC, or major histocompatibility complex. There's the MHC1. These are presented by all cells in the body. These consist of one long chain and one short chain. And the MHC1, when a cell is corrupted, will typically present corrupt self antigens and present this to your T killer cell or your cytotoxic T cell. Next, you have your MHC2, which is present on macrophages and dendritic cells. This, in turn, consists of two long chains, and these will present viral or bacterial antigens when it's phagocytosed by the macrophage, broken down into particles, and placed on the MHC2 for T cell recognition. So this is what they look like. T cells react to MHC particles. These are what your MHC particles look like. This over here is MHC1. On the left is MHC1. And it has, as I said, a long chain and a short chain. The long chain is going to present the corrupt self-antigen here for recognition by the T cytotoxic cell, right? And then next you have your MHC2, which has two long chains, this one and this one, and it's going to present a viral or bacterial antigen. This is presented on macrophages and dendrites, and it activates your T helper cell to augment the immune response. So there are several types of T helper cells. This is a mouthful. Bear with me for a while. First, you have your Th1 cells, which produce IL-2, tumor necrosis factor beta, and interferon gamma. These activate macrophages and promote cell-mediated immunity. Next, you have your Th2 cells, which produce a bunch of other cytokines, and these augment the humoral response. These are like the support of your B cells. I'll explain later as we discuss the various interleukins that are produced by T cells. Next, you have Th17 cells. I read in the book that these seem to have a role in autoimmunity and inflammation, and in bone marrow transplants, a lot of the T cells that are produced after bone marrow transplant seem to be Th17 cells. Although the book the sources that I read don't seem to elaborate much on their function. Then finally, T regulator cells. These are regulator T helper cells, and these prevent autoimmunity. These are the guys who will say, hey, hold up, you're mounting too much of an immune response. Hold down before you destroy our own body tissues, okay? So T cells develop just as B cells do, but these develop slightly differently. These begin again with your pluripotent stem cell in your bone marrow, but instead of going to peripheral lymphoid tissue, these go to your thymus. So T cells start first with your thymocyte or your T cell precursor, which expresses CD17 and CD3. So you expect all primitive T cells to express both of these CD7 and CD3. Then you have the common thymocyte. The thymocyte will migrate to the thymus and develop in the thymic cortex, or the outer portion of the thymus, and it'll start expressing both CD4 and CD8. And positive selection, as we mentioned earlier, is when the T cells are exposed to self-antigens. If these react, then these are eliminated. Next, you have the CD4 or the CD8 thymocyte. After this T cell passes positive selection, it'll go into the thymic medulla and it'll lose either one of CD4 or CD8. This will undergo negative selection, which again is when the CD4 or CD8 thymocyte is favored once it reacts to foreign antigens. And then once it passes this part of the test, it becomes a peripheral T cell, where it goes into the periphery, the lymph nodes, and then begins its actual T cell function. And then once it's exposed to foreign antigens, it turns into an activated mature T cell. Okay. Then finally, you have natural killer cells, the third kind of lymphocyte. These are cytotoxic cells important in mounting a defense against virus-infected cells and tumors. And these are not to be confused with cytotoxic T cells. These have the capacity to kill cells without being exposed prior to an antigen. So these are activated also by IL-2, and these possess MHC-1 receptors. However, unlike T cells, these receptors are the reverse. T cells will kill a cell that possesses MHC-1 and expresses a mutant antigen on that MHC-1. However, what if your cell mutates so that it doesn't know how to express MHC anymore? That's a dangerous sign, and therefore NK cells are important for this. These will kill cells that don't express MHC-1 molecules. Remember that MHC-1 is expressed by all the cells in your body, and NK cells will say, if a cell does not express MHC-1, then something's sketchy. I have to do something about it. So these will induce apoptosis in said cells. NK cells will increase in count also with bone marrow transplants, like Th17 cells. Now, we've been talking a lot about cells and then the chemicals that help promote and regulate the function of these lymphocytes are cytokines. Cytokines are released by white blood cells, particularly macrophages and also other lymphocytes. These serve as factors of growth and stimulators of inflammation. So there are several types. You have interleukins, interferons, and tumor necrosis factors. So first, you have several cytokines that are secreted by macrophages. You have IL-1, which stimulates production of IL-2. IL-1 causes acute inflammation and expression of adhesion molecules. Adhesion molecules are displayed in your endothelium of your blood vessels, and these allow neutrophils to stick on and do their chemotaxis, or entering and going through the blood vessel walls to go to the site of infection. And IL-1 also promotes differentiation of T cells. Next, you have IL-6. These are also produced by Th2 cells, apart from macrophages. And these promote fever. These are also known as neutrophil chemotactic factor. These stimulate production of B cells and Th17 cells, and these regulate hepcidin, which is found in your liver. These also inhibit T regulatory cells. These are expressed early on, and these will tell the T regulator cells, hey, inflammation is just about to start. Don't stop us just yet. Don't stop me now, like the song. Next, you have IL-12, which promotes differentiation of Th1 cells and cytotoxic T cells. Then you have tumor necrosis factor alpha, which activates your endothelium and promotes vascular leak, which allows neutrophils to pass through. Then you have cytokines that are secreted by T cells. As I mentioned earlier, you have IL-2, which drives T and NK cell differentiation and early B cell stimulation. Next, you have IL-3, which supports marrow stem growth and differentiation, and it also stimulates B cell growth and promotes cytotoxic T cells. Next, you have interferon gamma, which produced by Th1 and natural killer cells. These stimulate macrophages to lyse phagocytosed pathogens. So macrophages are going to eat bacteria. When exposed to interferon gamma, these will then proceed to use its lysosomes filled with enzymes to destroy the said pathogens and start generating antigens to display on MHC1. And it goes to show that these also increase expression of MHC molecules. These will also inhibit differentiation of Th2 cells. Next, you have IL-4. It's released by and promotes Th2 differentiation. These promote IgE and IgG production and inhibit Th1 and Th17 cells. IL-5, in turn, is released by Th2 cells as well, and it causes differentiation of eosinophils. It's a very long mnemonic, but I think that E is the fifth letter of the alphabet, and likewise, IL-5 promotes differentiation of E, eosinophils, which are also stimulated by IgE. However, IL-5 also promotes production of IgA, and some evidence hints that it probably also induces maturation of B cells. Next, you have IL-10. Which is secreted by Th2 and T regulator cells. These attenuate inflammation and decrease expression of IL-2. These inhibit macrophages and Th1 cells. So these put inflammation at a limit. And that, my friends, is my presentation of lymphocytes and all of the chemicals that are involved. Not all, but most of the important chemicals that are involved in lymphocyte production, differentiation, and action. Here are the references that I cited. I had to go through a lot of sources. My main guides were Hillman's Hematology and Clinical Practice, Taulez First Aid for U.S. Emily Step 1, and I also referred to Harrison's Principles of Internal Medicine. When these books got confusing, I referred to Romagnani, and I also referred to an ebook by Alberts et al., Molecular Biology of the Cell. Thank you so much for watching. I hope that wasn't too confusing. My tongue got a little tied, I'll admit, while talking, giving this video presentation. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope you learned something, and I hope that helped you with your review. What do you want to learn about next? If you have any ideas, if you have any requests, please let me know in the comments down below. I'm thinking of doing something more anatomy related in my next video. Also, if you like this, please press like and then press subscribe and hit the bell icon so that you can be informed of future videos. As always, this has been Life with Juan. Remember, live life to the fullest because you only have one life to live. Interleukins. Na 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 na.